Ladies and gentlemen, dear colleagues, it's a great, great pleasure for us to welcome you at the Max Planck Institute Luxembourg for this conference on debacles. Due to a bet I made some weeks ago, I will not make any play on words on debacles or on the weather, because I'm at risk of losing my bet. So, but this being said, for most of you, it's your first time at the Max Planck Institute, but I very much hope it's not the last one. You will discover the place. You have all around brochures about the Institute so that you can be made a bit more aware of what we do. And of course, feel free to visit the Institute. There are many researchers in the room who are able to guide you for a tour so that you have a feeling of what the Institute is. I would like, before all, to thank the staff of the Institute and the team which has prepared this conference. You have all noticed the very nice organization of the conference, and I'm free to say this because I'm not the one doing the work. And we have a very nice team, and some of you have seen how devoted they are in doing their best for you to be able to reach the Institute despite any strike. So thank you to this team and very nice and willing people. And of course, I would like also to thank Lorenzo Gradoni, who has imagined this conference, has had the idea of the topic, and has worked a lot in order to make it a big success by selecting people, being in touch with you, reflecting on the topic, and putting all this all together. So if you have any intellectual question or scientific question related to the conference, don't come to me, come to Lorenzo. He will be the one going on leading the project. So thank you, Lorenzo, for this big work. So we have a very busy day ahead. We have done our best. Some recommendations. The conference is podcasted, and so then you will be radio recorded. This is why you receive some equipment, and this is why we will ask the speakers to stand at the lectern for the sake of this video recording. So thank you for taking this into account, and like any other podcast of our events, it will be put on our website and on our YouTube channel. So it's a way of giving some to the conference beside the publication. Also, I mentioned that these are very busy days, so what I will do now is a call for discipline in terms of keeping time. And so try not to be brief. It's not possible for maybe academics, but nevertheless, try to hold the time, to keep the time, and so that we will have a relaxed conference where we can mix nicely social moments and more scientific moments. So this is why I will stop here. I will not go into the merits of this conference. You will all do this. Last but not least, I would like just to underline, you have all noticed that this is a conference of young academics mostly, but young but already senior in their scientific advancement academics, and this was a deliberate choice that we made, and I have to say that I'm really happy with this choice, and once again congratulations to Lorenzo for having imagined this. So I wish you all a very nice conference, and now we can open it. Thank you very much.
Okay, good morning everyone, and welcome to the first panel of this conference. I'm very grateful to the organizers of this conference who kindly invited me to take part in this exciting workshop, and this is particularly true with regard to the first panel on theoretical issues. After I think an unprecedented period of dramatic progress in international adjudication, we face some setbacks in the recent years. I think that the talk of some experts about the great decline of international adjudication or international law in general they are somewhat overstated, or at least to my mind, in every system we have some ups and downs. But anyhow, the fact that this prestigious institute devote a conference for a serious analysis of some failures in international adjudication, I believe that it testifies that we are having a mature, very mature branch of international law, and that the scholars in this field are ready also to draw some important lessons from some failures. We have three very interesting papers, and I will give you just some flavors about the shape of the things to come. In the first panel, Dr. Luca Pasquet, he would talk about how should we define success or failure of international tribunals. Of course, it is related to our social expectations. I mean, once we have very high expectations about any institution, we are more likely to be disappointed, I'm using his words. And of course, it is also related in many cases to some struggles within our epistemic community. The second paper by Professor Almeida and Professor Forlati, it is largely addresses a very interesting issue with regard to the links between compliance or non-compliance with judgments of international tribunals and the success or failure of these tribunals. And finally, Dr. Wim Muller, he would talk about the particular challenge involved in litigation or adjudication against great powers. So each speaker, or altogether, we are going to have 45, 50 minutes of these three presentations, and then we would open the floor for your questions. And I think that based on these very interesting papers, we may well have a lively discussion also at the end of these three presentations. So the first speaker is Dr. Luca Pasquet, and just a few words about him. Dr. Pasquet holds a PhD in international law from the Graduate Institute of International and Development Studies of Geneva. He also has a master's degree in law from the University of Torino. His dissertation, PhD dissertation, focused on the relationships between immunities of international organizations and the right to have an access to court. Between 2011 and 2014, he worked as a teaching assistant at the Graduate Institute in Geneva, and his current research interests include legal pluralism, international systemic law, legal theory, international immunities, and human rights. And the topic of his presentation here today is failure as disappointment. Dr. Pasquet, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Professor Isch. And also, I would like to thank all the organizers of this conference, especially Professor Gradoni and Nathalie Perrin and Professor Ruiz Fabri. As you see, the title is Failure as Disappointment, and I will start by disappointing the president, because actually what he has said related to my paper, and I decided that in my presentation I will be slightly different from what I written in the paper in terms of focus. Of course, what you said about
based on your paper
is based on my paper, and then you will hear something slightly different. But okay, let's start. So the basic idea of behind this title, Failure is Disappointment, is that failure, the idea of failure in international adjudication has to do with the disappointment of the court's social environment or the court's audience, depending on the theoretical framework we want to use. I will get to that, but before I will make a few considerations on the way we, as international lawyers, speak of failure in the field of international adjudication. Of course, as Professor Hirsch said, as I wrote in my paper, we say that there is a failure when something disappoints our expectations. But this also means that we will have a clear idea of what is failure when we have very strong shared premises about what international adjudication should be or should do. And I think that we don't have these strong shared premises. And this is why I've called it terra incognita. A little anecdote. When I saw the call for paper for this conference, I thought I would write a case study. Then I realized that in order to write a case study, I needed to know what counts as failure. Otherwise, I cannot select the right study, the right case. So I started searching for a generally recognized idea of failure or success in international adjudication in the discourse of international lawyers. But as you see, the fact that I'm not presenting a case study means that I have not found it. I will try to be a bit clearer on this point. So I think that the main problem here is the indeterminacy of the concept of failure, and of course of the concept of success in international adjudication. We do not have a strong shared understanding of these ideas, but we rather have different ideas as to what constitutes failure. Of course, this does not mean that we cannot speak about it, and we can agree on the qualification of extreme cases as failures. I'm thinking, for instance, to the case in which a tribunal's activity has been suspended by state members, as in the case of the South African Development Community Tribunal. We will hear about this case in this conference. But then, in other cases, which are not so extreme cases, it seems that it is always debatable whether a court is a failure or not, a success or not. It depends. And so, of course, there will be lutte de classement, semantic struggles, to quote Ingo Wenzke, epistemic struggles to define what failure is. But at this point, it seems to me we don't have shared premises about it. Of course, we try to avoid indeterminacy by resorting to quantification, because every analysis which is grounded on measurable data appears more objective in a way. And so we develop quantitative indicators, such as usage rate or compliance rates, in order to try to define failure. But this approach is illusionary in a way, and it reproduces indeterminacy for two reasons. First, international adjudication is very diverse. So it is difficult, maybe impossible, to develop some universal one-fits-all indicators. Second, and probably most important, quantification answers to the question how much, but cannot answer to the question how much is enough to be a success or not to be a failure, in a way. To answer this question, we need some shared understanding, but do we have it? Probably not. So the discourse on success or failure in international adjudication is framed in terms of quantitative effectiveness. In short, we think, more or less, that we have a lot of inputs and a lot of outputs for a court, for a tribunal, so to have a lot of cases to deal with and a lot of decisions and a lot of compliance from states is a good thing. It is a success. The contrary case is a failure. But this approach doesn't say much as to the moral value of the activity of courts. It says more about how and how much courts function, but it is different. So it is a value-neutral approach, in a way. Yet, this is probably the consequence of the fact we do not have shared premises, a shared understanding of what international courts should do or should be. So, if we focus on functioning, as we are focusing on functioning, failure is either failure to function or failure to persist, a failure to survive of a certain institution. I admit that this is clearly a low threshold for success. But there are probably two explanations for this low threshold. The first is that, as I was saying before, the semantic of quantitative effectiveness only allows to measure functioning, nothing else. Second, and most important, I think we can say that such young institutions as courts and tribunals, international courts and tribunals, are still very weak. Survival is for them a big issue. In a way, to survive is itself a success for them. This is something we have to take into account when assessing international courts. We cannot ask too much to courts and tribunals, international courts and tribunals, because they have to function, after all. They have to survive. So I think that the dimension of survival is important to understand what we mean when we talk about failure in international adjudication, in the field of international adjudication. I will take the dimension of survival seriously. And to do so, I will refer to the metaphor of the struggle for survival. You see the beard of Darwin. The main ideas I would like to stress in respect to this metaphor are, first, that from this perspective, success corresponds to survival and failure to extinction. And two, that survival depends on the capacity of adaptation of an institution, in this case, to the environment. These ideas have been applied in many forms to social sciences, but in particular, I will refer to David Easton's political model, a framework for political analysis. For him, the survival of a political system depends on the support it receives from its social environment. Support can be seen as the commitment of an actor towards the system, or towards the authorities of the system. And thus, this is important, as the capacity of the system to mobilize the energies and the resources of its environment. It is like a tree which absorbs energies and resources from the environment. Of course, a tree doesn't have to have the support of the environment for that. Courts must ask permission, in a way. This support, in the case of international courts, is achieved if the system is able to satisfy the demands of the relevant actors. And this model can be applied to courts if we see them as political actors. By the way, it has already been applied to international arbitration by Thomas Schulz and Cédric Dupont. So the basic idea is that there is an interaction between international courts and their social environment, and that this relation is key for the survival of the court. Indeed, the relevant actors can show their disappointment towards the decision taken by courts and tribunals in many ways. Their reactions can be dangerous and take different forms. If I made a list of the ways in which they can show their disappointment, the relevant actors for the courts. Of course, it's not an exhaustive list, but okay. States can suspend the court's activity, as an example of the South African Development Communities Tribunal I referred before, or they can restrict the court jurisdiction. Here, the case maybe is not as well known as the first one. It is the case of the Eurasian Economic Community, that is now the Eurasian Economic Union's court, that on the 10th July 2013 declared in a preliminary ruling that its decision should have been directly applied on the territory of state members. But state members didn't like the idea, so they reacted by restricting the jurisdiction of the court in a very serious way. So, for instance, they eliminated any reference to preliminary ruling jurisdiction, and then they added provisions in the statutes according to which the court cannot create new legal norms and does not have power to create competence for the Eurasian institutions in addition to those provided in the treaties. So basically no implied powers. Then, of course, a state can just avoid to comply with the decision of courts. And interestingly, national and international courts can also play a role in this because they can suggest or declare that for a state to comply with a certain decision, a certain judgment would be illegitimate or illegal. Then they can remove themselves from the jurisdiction of the court. It is a unilateral action, but domino effects are also possible. They can stop paying dues. And potential claimants, also different from states, for instance, individuals or investors, could ignore, in the abstract, they could ignore the court or the tribunal, and that would be a failure. Okay, some of these reactions alone can perhaps lead to the failure of the system, yet survival also depends on the capacity of the court to react to the reactions of their environment. So this is what this slide is about. To increase the level of support they enjoy, courts should satisfy the demands coming from their environment. Yet, this can be difficult if the demands coming from the environment are different the one from the others. So, in short, the court has to choose. And here I've listed three main strategies courts can follow to deal with the feedbacks they receive from their environment. The first strategy consists in choosing to satisfy the demands of the most powerful actor, which are also the most dangerous for the court. According to some authors, this is what the ICC, the International Criminal Court, is doing with respect to Western states. An alternative strategy would be to satisfy different demands in different decisions taken in different moments of time. Of course, in this case, there would be a problem of inconsistency, but courts can try to hide inconsistency by justifying their decision by reference to vague or fluid notions, such as, for instance, the notion of reasonableness or the idea of the margin of appreciation. Of course, you can justify two very different things by referring to reasonableness. You can say they are both reasonable, even if they're very different, the one from the other. Third, the last strategy. Also here, the list is not exhaustive, but it's just to give you an idea. Courts could neutralize individual disappointment by evoking some kind of collective or superior good, transcending individual interest. Actors willing to attack the court would therefore expose themselves to criticisms of selfishness. These are ways in which the court tries to survive. And finally, this is the last slide. This relationship between the system and the environment is also reminiscent of the relationship described by Perelman and Olbrecht Titecka between a speaker and its audience. According to the latter model, the speaker needs to persuade an audience in order to secure its adherence. And the final end of the speaker could be to push the audience to an action. Yet, there is also a difference, in my opinion, if we shift of perspective. If we shift to the audience paradigm, somehow we have to raise the threshold of what constitutes success. Limiting disappointment of the environment is no longer enough. One could argue that, according to this model, success is the capacity to convince the broadest possible audience. I will make an example by asking whether the ISDS, so investment arbitration, is a success or a failure. Well, according to the first model, the model of survival, it seems it is a success because it survives quite well. The most relevant actors, but only them, are quite happy with the system. And also, it functions very well in terms of inputs and outputs. We have a lot of claims, quite a number of decisions. We can write a lot of comments on it. Yet, if we shift off perspective and we apply the speaker-audience interaction model, we see that the system is unable to persuade a broader audience. Whenever the public opinion and civil society realize that actually this system exists, we assist to strong negative reactions. Western voters do not seem to like it. And in order to survive, this system should make probably itself inconspicuous and only address investment experts and corporations. That would secure its own survival. But then that would seem a failure from the perspective of the capacity to persuade. Why? Because a speaker can select the right argument for a specific audience, but it cannot select the audience for a specific argument. So maybe in the end, since this is the end, President, we have found a criterion to set the threshold a bit higher than mere survival. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Dr. Paske, for structural analysis. Very interesting. The first paper is presented by two speakers, Professor Paula Almeida, Vojkovic Almeida. She has a master's degree from University of Paris, 11. She got a PhD degree from École des droits de la Université de Paris, Sorbonne. She's professor of international and European law at the Vargas Foundation Law School in Rio de Janeiro. She's also an associate researcher at the Institute of International and European Law at the Sorbonne. Sorry. She's a member of the Center for Studies on Judiciary and Society at the Foundation Law School, and she is also the chair of the Latin American Society Interest Group on International Courts and Tribunals. And the following speaker is Professor Forlati. She is an associate professor of international law at the Department of Law of the University of Ferrara. She holds an LLM degree from Bruges University and PhD from Rome University. She's a co-convener of the European Society of International Law Interest Group on International Courts and Tribunals. She's the director of Center for Studies of Services on Foreign Law and International Relations at Department of Law at the University of Ferrari. And she's the founding member and co-coordinator of the Research Center on Mafia and Other Forms of Organized Crime at the University of Ferrara. And the title of their presentation is Non-Compliance with Judgment, a Failure of International Adjudication? Question mark, please.
Thank you very much, Professor Hirsch. And I'm delighted to be here with you today. And I would like to thank Professor Hélène Ruiz-Fabry, Professor Grandoni, Lorenzo Grandoni, and all the members of the organizing committee, Martina, Simoni, for making it possible for me to be here with you. So before proceeding into our part one, it is important from the outset to define our main interest in this research, in this paper, which is to assess whether success or failure of international adjudication can be solely measured by compliance with international judgments, in particular the judgments rendered by the ICJ. The focus on the ICJ responds to the structural differences among international courts and tribunals, which makes it difficult to draw conclusions that would apply uniformly to all of them. So any comparative study should consider the political, geographical, and cultural context in which different courts operate, as well as their mandate and their subject. And our hypothesis here is that judgment compliance is not in itself the sole criterion capable of capturing the full relevance of potential of international adjudication. Indeed, a judgment that was not complied with may contribute in any case to international law and to produce impact over domestic authorities. And we intend to demonstrate that ICJ judgments, no matter being complied with or not, appear capable of developing normative expectations and long-term impacts to international law. We depart from a multifunctional approach that transcends the traditional understanding according to which international courts and tribunals would be limited to the bilateral dispute settlement between states. It takes into account other important functions that international courts currently perform in order to attain the objective of realizing international justice. Being aware of the different functions performed by international courts and tribunals as addressed by the doctrine in different ways will focus not only on dispute settlement, which can be considered ICJ's primary function, but also on developing international law, which is currently the most prominent one as regards with regards to the ICJ. And we believe that success of international courts, in particular the ICJ, can be measured upon the accomplishment of their functions. So taking into account these points, our research plan is subdivided into two parts, and here is the French influence. two parts, but no, we try to organize it, but then we would like to receive your feedback on this. So in the first part, I will discuss the possibility of assessing success or failure of international adjudication on the basis of compliance. Then I'll pass the floor to my colleague, Serena Forlati, to further develop part two. So there are specific strategies through which international courts can promote norm compliance. These strategies may combine legal and political instruments being binding or non-binding. Since much has been written on the enforcement of ICJ decisions, on enforcement of ICJ decisions, our paper briefly recalled the theoretical framework provided by the UN Charter, as well as its challenges and prospects. And this is our first point there. As widely known, the post-adjudicative phase in international law is clearly political and not followed by a judicial examination. It is a matter for the Security Council. And we are not going to further develop this in the presentation, but just mention that in order to depoliticize this process, our paper also discusses some possible alternatives, such as an extension of the court's competence by an amendment of the statute and rules. The second possibility would be the application of the theory of inherent powers, according to which the jurisdiction of the court would encompass general enforcement measures, which would be inherent to the statute, as discussed in the alleged violations case, and also the use of the mechanism at the several mechanisms at the disposal of the ICJ, so that it can actively participate in the enforcement of its decisions. And this is notably the case of the mechanism on provisional measures and its monitoring system, and the application for revision of a judgment, in which the court is allowed to require previous compliance with its principal judgment. So other international courts and tribunals have taken a proactive role in this process of enforcement of its final decisions, such as the European Court of Human Rights and the Inter-American Court of Human Rights, and more intrusively, the European Court of Justice. It is important to note as well that internal and external factors affect the extent to which compliance will be achieved. A thorough study of all possible reasons behind non-compliance with ICJ judgments falls beyond the scope of our research. Our focus here is on internal aspects currently linked to non-compliance, such as the jurisdictional powers of the court and the nature and substance of the judgments that are rendered by the court. there are potential factors linked to the judgment itself that may affect compliance. Inherent factors such as the ambiguity in a judgment and its onerous or intrusive character can also act as a barrier to implementation and therefore to compliance. So what is the consequence of a recalcitrant state not complying with a judgment for the success or failure of international adjudication, and especially the International Court of Justice? Compliance is not the determinant for the settlement of international disputes. For example, there are cases in which disputes can be settled by other means without a state complying with a judgment. Also, the court can influence a state's conduct. And finally, the judgments may also have a passive, what we used to call in doctrine, a pacifying effect for the parties in dispute. This discussion confirms that the lack of compliance with final judgments of international courts and tribunals is not per se a symptom of their failure. Even when it is analyzed in the light of a limited approach to international adjudication, which would be dispute settlement. Success or failure has to take into account other functions exercised by international courts, as will be discussed by my colleague. So thank you very much, and I'll pass the floor to Serena right now.
Thank you very much. And I would also like to thank the organizers for inviting us to present our views on this topic. I will address the possible impact of the systemic contribution of international courts and tribunals to the development of specific international legal regimes and of international law more broadly as a factor possibly counterbalancing non-compliance with judgments and therefore preventing the failure of an international court or tribunal. In our paper, we decided to address the issue, firstly by looking at the specific relationship between non-compliance and the capacity of the ICJ to develop this, to develop international law, or at least to contribute to clarifying and elucidating the contents of international legal rules. I will be very quick in this presentation in discussing these cases due to time restraints, but what clearly comes out of the analysis we made is that this systemic impact of international adjudication, at least for the ICJ on international law, does not really depend in any way on the compliance with a specific judgment in which this law developing function is performed. I will just mention very briefly two cases among the ones we have analyzed in different areas of concerning different areas of international law in which this is particularly clear. First of all, the 1986 Nicaragua United States judgment, which, as we all know, I think, was not acknowledged as binding by the United States. Jurisdiction of the court was ferociously contested by the United States, and it is only after the Sandinist government in Nicaragua was overturned and the election of a new government came in place that it was possible to negotiate an agreement, an overall comprehensive agreement, changing the relationship between the two countries. And eventually, the compensations phase of the case was not concluded because of this new settlement. But the importance of the Nicaragua judgment and of its findings on the international legal regime relating to the use of force is hardly possible to overstate it. Many different areas of this specific issue have been clarified by the International Court. Let's think only of the relationship between the legal regime enshrined in the UN Charter and in customary international law. The other interesting case, I think, or we think, is the Germany versus Italy case, to which reference has already been made. It is well known that the Italian Constitutional Court has considered that it was would be impossible to implement the judgment in the national legal order of Italy. I would not like to discuss here whether the judgment is a good or a bad assessment of international law, regardless of whether we consider it to be an exemplary reconstruction of customary international law or as a missed opportunity. The very clear thing, the very clear conclusion is that this judgment has, for the time being, frozen any prospects of development of international law in this area, and the stance taken by the European Court of Human Rights in the Jones versus United Kingdom case is very clear in assessing the authoritative impact of the ICJ findings in this regard, and the fact that it felt complied to consider that as a authoritative and in some respects persuasive finding of this as to the state of customary international law. So if this is the case, what we tried also to look at is whether the this capacity to influence the development of international law as being independent from compliance could apply also to other international courts and tribunals. It is, I think, quite clear that this is the case. Other international courts and tribunals have a role in developing international law that is perhaps not as strong as the one of the ICJ, but clearly works in the same way, both within specific legal systems to which the court, in the framework of which courts are established, and also outside those systems, as in the form of cross-fertilization between different approaches to different judicial institutions. What we tried to look at is to consider whether the structural features of each international court or tribunal somehow affect their role in developing normative expectations, and whether this can act as a counterbalancing non-compliance in assessing the success or failure of international courts. I will be very brief. We can expand this in the discussion if you want. It is quite clear that also international, that some of the structural features of the International Court of Justice that were put in place precisely to enhance its law development role do play a similar role also as regards other international courts and tribunals. Not all of them, though. For instance, the advisory function of the International Court of Justice has played a major role in allowing it to perform this function of developing international law, even at a time where the contentious function of the court was rarely resorted to and the court was virtually without any case to decide upon in its contentious as to its contentious jurisdiction. But this kind of feature is not something that can play the same kind of role also for other international courts and tribunals because of the very strong differences in the framing of this competence in different institutions. The Inter-American Court of Human Rights has a very similar and even broader advisory competence, but other international courts have a much more restricted advisory competence in order to avoid overlaps with the contentious jurisdiction they are endowed with. And in some instances, let's think, for instance, of the advisory preliminary rulings mechanisms that are typical of some jurisdictions. There, the function of advisory jurisdiction is completely different. So this is not really a key feature we consider. Also, compulsory jurisdiction may play a role in enhancing the law development function of international courts, but after all, the International Court of Justice is not endowed with compulsory jurisdiction, and maybe its impact is rather on the attitude taken by an international court and tribunal on in the exercise of this sanction, whether it's a more evaluative or a more conservative assessment of the contents of the law, rather than influencing the existence of this function generally. We consider that the most important elements to take into account are, on the one hand, the permanent composition of an international court and tribunal, and on the second hand, the multilateral nature of its statutes or governing bodies, and also of the substantive law each international court and tribunal is called upon to apply. The permanent composition of international courts is indeed a factor enhancing the coherence in the case law and the possibility of a long-term impact on the system each court is called upon to govern in a way. This is very clear, for instance, for the Permanent Court of International Justice, which was set up as a permanent court precisely in order to be able to develop a coherent body of case law. It's certainly the same can apply to the International Court of Justice. The WTO appellate body was set up also with this kind of function in mind. And certainly the systemic impact of the European Court of Human Rights judgments is related to the existence of a permanent jurisdiction. Also, this is not really to do specifically with the low development function, but whenever permanent courts are at stake, the refusal to comply with judgments may be very focused on one specific judgment and not imply a complete rejection of the functions of a court. This may sort of soften the effects of non-compliance over success, any assessment as to success or failure of a court. The situation may be different as regards ad hoc tribunals, which focus on two parties in a dispute and speak only to those two parties, at least in principle. Of course, even ad hoc tribunals do play a role in elucidating international law, in this kind of situation, the impact of non-compliance may be higher. At the same time, one should keep in mind the fact that some institutional forms of arbitrations are connected to broader systems of adjudication. I think, for instance, and most notably, to the situation of arbitration under the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea, where ad hoc arbitral tribunals interpret a specific body of substantive law and are part of a broader institutional framework which includes also two permanent courts. In this kind of context, our contention is that the law development function is much broader and it can effectively counterbalance non-compliance. And as probably the Philippines versus China arbitration could show, there is really no prospect of that arbitration being of the merits award in that arbitration to be implemented anytime soon. But not only the award is likely to influence the negotiating table with its careful assessment of the facts relating to and of the qualification of the maritime features that were at stake in the case, but also more broadly because it has an impact over the overall system of the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea. So very, very briefly, our conclusions. The impact of non-compliance on the success or failure of international adjudication varies also in light of the functions other than settling or deciding disputes that are the primary functions of most international courts. On the other hand, cases such as Southwest Africa show that a court can fail also for reasons that are totally unrelated to compliance. The court there decided that it could not decide on the merits of the dispute that was submitted to it, and this led to one of the major crises in the life of the International Court of Justice. And also, this case can show us how the problem relates, or the failure in this case, related to a legal technical question. So maybe the court failed in the assessment law component of its adjudication function. But at the same time, probably the case was perceived so negatively by the community it was directed to, also because it failed to provide any meaningful contribution to the to the settlement of the dispute the court was called to decide upon. So as a way of very brief conclusion, this case really shows how international courts fail when they fail to exercise all of their functions in a meaningful way. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much for a very interesting presentation. Perhaps we'll discuss it during the Q&A. I mean, I think that Nicaragua case is indeed a fascinating case that we can make a clear distinction between non-compliance, at least in the following years after the judgment is rendered, but normatively very much influential on international customary law. So it depends whether you want to define it as great success or failure. Our next speaker, Dr. V. Muller, is a lecturer in public international law at the Faculty of Law of the University of Maastricht. He's also an associate fellow in the Chatham House in the International Law Program. He holds an LLM degree and doctor degree from the European University Institute in Florence. From 2014 to 2015, he was a research associate at the School of Law at the University of Manchester. Between 2008 and 2013, he was also a researcher at the European University Institute. And in the past, he also served as an advocate in the delegation of Bosnia and Herzegovina to the International Court of Justice. And the topic of his presentation here would be now international adjudication against great powers. Dr. Muller, please.
Thank you very much, Professor Hirsch. And I would also like to thank the organizers for having me here. It's a great pleasure to be at this very, very well-organized conference. So, yeah, I'm going to talk about the question of international adjudication about great powers. Basically, the trigger for this, my interest in this topic is the arbitration award in the Philippines against China case, which was rendered in July this year and caused a lot of publicity and a lot of negative publicity about China. There were many comments after that case in which China refused to participate in this arbitration about precedents and about other powers not participating in international cases, and most commonly they referred to the Arctic Sunrise case, which was an arbitration which was started almost at the same time by the Netherlands against Russia, as well as previously the Nicaragua case before the ICJ. I also did this myself in a few comments, and actually that led me to think, okay, maybe it might be a good idea to examine a bit more deeply whether this assumption that if a smaller state takes up international litigation against a great power, that this is a more risky enterprise or is necessarily destined for failure. So I will be using these three cases as a case study in my presentation. And it's based on a number of assumptions. First of all, it's based on the well-known difference that there is between the fact that states are each other's sovereign equals, but that there's in reality an inequality of power in the international order. As for example, Gary Simpson wrote about in his book on great powers and outlaw states, and which has also been noted by many other authors. And in particular, a question in these three cases is that it is also about objections raised by these great powers against the jurisdiction of the ICJ in the case of Nicaragua and compulsory UNCLOS arbitration in the other two cases, when previously this great power has accepted the jurisdiction of this international adjudicatory body, but then later it voices objections against them. Because normally we would assume that it is the competence of this adjudicatory body to then determine whether these objections to its jurisdiction are valid. But in all three cases, what happened is that the great power decided that that there was no jurisdiction and decided not to participate in the proceedings as a result. Now, this needs to be balanced then against the interest, the assessment of their interests that these great powers make, which I will talk about a little bit later. But I think in the course of this research, at least as an important of departure, one thing that I found, which was a subject of discussion, especially during the Nicaragua case, but which we haven't heard much from about since, is the so-called Connolly Clause that was included in the optional clause declaration that the United States made in 1946 when it accepted the compulsory jurisdiction of the ICJ. At the time, in this reservation, it included, or in this in this optional clause declaration, it added a clause saying that issues which were essentially within the domestic jurisdiction of the United States, as interpreted by the United States, would fall outside of the reach of the United States optional clause declaration. And that sounds a little bit strange, because it's like you give permission to the court to exercise its jurisdiction with one hand, and with the other one you take it back immediately. Now, I think this the Connolly Clause actually is exemplary for this the attitude which is displayed by all three great powers in these three cases, because in each three of them, they reserve for themselves the competence to assess whether or not they have actually consented to the jurisdiction of this adjudicatory body. And one underlying question would therefore also be whether only states with a certain position in the international order can get away with this. So the questions that I will try to address in each three cases is, why did those states in the specific cases choose not to appear? Why did they not participate in these cases? What were the consequences, both in litigation with regard to especially to the task of the adjudicatory body in question to take into account the legal interests of the respondent which did not participate? Whether this non-appearance was fatal to the proceedings and led to inferior judgments or outcomes, something which has already been spoken about also by the previous speakers, and whether it really led to something that we can call failure. So to begin with, there's the Nicaragua case, of course known to everyone, especially also because both Professor Hirsch and the previous speakers refer to the importance that it has assumed in the years subsequent to it for the as an authoritative interpretation of the law on self-defense and in other areas, most notably state responsibility. Now, the difference between this case and the other two is, of course, that it's a case before the International Court of Justice, but also that the US did initially participate in the case. It raised preliminary objections against the proceedings instituted by Nicaragua, heavily contested the jurisdiction, and it only decided not to participate in the proceedings any further after it lost the proceedings on the preliminary objections. Now, the jurisdiction in the case was based both on the optional clause declaration that the United States had made under Article 36, paragraph 2 of the ICJ statute, as well as a still existing friendship treaty between Nicaragua and the United States. I referred to the Connolly Clause in my introduction. It is important to note that the court did not, that Nicaragua did not rely on this declaration, and the court did not rely on this declaration for its jurisdiction in the case, also because the United States didn't rely on that. The United States, instead of relying on this Connolly Clause, actually made a reservation 3 days prior to Nicaragua instituting the proceedings before the court, saying that it excluded its optional clause acceptance of the court's jurisdiction against any state in Central America. So that seems a highly customized new reservation that it made. And the court itself was quite divided on the exact basis for the jurisdiction. So there was some disagreement whether it was the friendship treaty or the optional clause declaration, but eventually it ruled against the United States objections. Now, this created, of course, problems both for Nicaragua and for the court itself in the merits phase, because suddenly the respondent was no longer appearing and the court still needed to exercise its judicial function and make sure that the legal interests of the United States were safeguarded in the eventual judgment. In this case, it was helped by the fact that the United States did actually also make some substantive submissions even during the preliminary phase, and that some of its other substantive positions were also known through a number of available public sources. So this enabled the court still to rely on those sources in its assessment of the legal position of the United States. What we also see is that the fact that the United States did not participate, and that therefore you could see that say that there were certain procedural flaws to the eventual judgment, did not prevent the judgment from eventually becoming very influential and being one of the most cited and most quoted judgments in international law doctrine. So, in that respect, the Nicaragua case has certain properties of its own, but we see that maybe, as the previous speaker said, the non-participation of the U.S. did have certain consequences for its compliance and its direct influence as a judgment that was supposed to settle a dispute between two parties, but it didn't prevent it from having a major impact on the development of international law. Now, the second case, the South China Sea arbitration, was instituted by the Philippines following the ongoing tensions in the South China Sea, which had been recurring in the past few decades, and was a bit of a departure diplomatically from what had been happening before. It was known that China had a very extensive claim to this nine-dash line in the South China Sea, and when China acceded to the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea, it did not make any reservations against the compulsory jurisdiction provided for in Annex 7, but it did so a few years later in 2005. And in a declaration it made at the time, it reserved the jurisdiction of Annex 7 dispute settlement as much as was possible within the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea. So from that moment on, China felt relatively safe, but the Philippines used a fairly innovative strategy when it instituted the case by excluding all possible topics which would come within China's reservation and arguing that it was basically only instituting a case about maritime entitlements, which were still covered by compulsory dispute settlement. Now, this meant that I still think that if China had actually bothered to appear before the arbitral tribunal and voice its jurisdictional objections, it might have had a good chance to persuade the arbitral tribunal that it wouldn't, that it shouldn't proceed with the case, because afterwards the award has also been criticized in quite a few quarters for being for basically not taking these restrictions into account and also taking quite an innovative approach to maritime delimitation and not addressing that issue while immediately proceeding to examination of the status of features in the South China Sea. Now, an interesting part about China's non-participation is that China seems to regret deciding not to participate in the proceedings from the beginning by trying to put its legal position in the public domain. This happened first with regard to a publication by academics who were sympathetic to the Chinese position. It's called The China Sea Arbitration, A Chinese Perspective. And this book explicitly intends to be a bit of an amicus curiae brief. But then also later China decided to put a position paper on its position with regard to the South China Sea on the website of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. So this seems to suggest that China did have second thoughts about its non-participation, but in order not to lose face and to maintain its formal non-acceptance of the proceedings, it did take care not to be seen as participating in the proceedings at all. This was also evidenced by certain informal approaches to the judges or to the members of the arbitral tribunal during the proceedings, which probably annoyed those members more than that it contributed to them taking China's position, looking at China's position favorably. Another outcome of this arbitration is, and this was also mentioned by the previous speakers, is that the award is quite ambitious and that it addresses many, many open questions about the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea. As was said, it might have it might not lead to formal compliance, definitely not in the long term, probably never in the long term, but it will probably lead to quite a bit of, it will influence both the negotiation positions of the different parties in the South China Sea, including China, even though it won't admit to this, and it might have an impact on the development of the law of the sea in the future. Now the third case study, well, okay, the images of Taiping Island, this is not an island according to the award, which was obviously criticized. So. The third case, and here I need to be careful because Marco Benatar is in the audience, the Arctic Sunrise case between the Netherlands and Russia was about, as probably most audience members know, a Greenpeace ship which had been seized by the Russian authorities because of its activities near an oil platform, and including the people on the ship. The Netherlands instituted the proceedings because it was exercising diplomatic protection over those Arctic 30 and also claiming its rights as the flagship state under compulsory UNCLOS arbitration. Russia decided not to appear from the beginning, and the difference between this case and the other ones is that Russia maintained this position. There's not really any evidence of the Russian legal position as far as I have found, other than the diplomatic exchanges which it had with the Netherlands on the specific, in regard to the objections which the Netherlands raised as a flag state, but it did not appear in the provisional measures proceedings. It declined to appear there, and it also sent a note verbal to signify that it would not participate in the arbitration. So, eventually, Russia did release the ship as well as the Arctic 30. That might mean that it complied, but it did so much later than the arbitration tribunal ordered, and it's unclear to what extent its decision to do so was actually influenced by the award. Well, if we look at these three cases, we shouldn't forget that there have been other cases in which states decided not to appear in proceedings as well. The nuclear test case is another P5 power. We could still argue that France is a great power and behaved as such in that case, but it never really proceeded to the merits because the object of the case became moot, so that remains unclear. Of these cases, I think the two that kind of maybe challenge the assumption that it's only great powers which can afford not to appear are the diplomatic and consular staff case or the Tehran hostages case, in which Iran didn't appear because the revolutionary regime had just seized power and basically decided that the court was an illegitimate Western imperialist tool, as well as the Slovenia and Croatia arbitration of two relatively equally sized countries, in which Slovenia basically used the carrot of EU membership to force Croatia to come to accept this arbitration over a territorial issue. But after some procedural irregularities caused by the Slovenian agent and the arbiter appointed by Slovenia, Croatia decided that it did not want to continue with the proceedings and has been very reluctant to find a solution to deal with these irregularities. So you could say there that Croatia made a new assessment of its interests and decided that it was not worth it to appear anymore. So what can we learn from these different cases? Well, the individual characteristics of the three cases do show differences. The US and the Russia behave much more confidently when they decide not to appear. Once they don't appear, they don't participate in the proceedings anymore. Whereas China, as a relative newcomer and also a relatively new emerging power, still apparently felt insecure enough to make its legal position known and therefore show insecurity about its non-participation. What it also does is demonstrate that law is only one factor in a complex assessment that states make about their self-interests. Basically, litigation is one tool out of many, and maybe what we can learn from these cases is just that great powers have more relative power, and therefore it's easier for them to go for this full option of not participating in proceedings. But if you look closer at different cases and cases of international litigation, you will also see that that different states will also change their litigation strategies depending on their assessments of their interests within the litigation. And this is something which is less immediately outwardly visible, but which is more familiar to people who have actually participated in the cases. I'm also thinking, for example, about the way Serbia conducted itself in all the various litigation which it was involved in from the late 1990s. So, what would we say? I don't think that that the great power litigation between small states and great powers is therefore destined for failure, because it depends on how we define failure, as has also been said by the previous speakers. But it does show that smaller states need to seriously consider their relative power and position and what they can gain from the kind of litigation against great powers, because they do run the risk that those powers would decide that their interests are not harmed all that much, and that the reputational damage that they suffer as a result of not participating is more limited than if we're talking about powers of a more equal size. It also, and that's my final point, shows, and here I connect back to a point that Luca Pasquet made, that the building blocks of international adjudication remain very, very fragile, and that's that's international adjudication is still very much a work in progress, and that we need to take that into account. Thank you.
Thank you very much to Dr. Muller. I think that he brought something important on the juncture of IRIL, international relations and international law, about some legal strategy of superpowers or great powers about not appearing before the tribunals, but we should pay attention that it's not the same with compliance, at least with regard to the Russian case. I mean, we have a compliance, but we don't see appearance before the tribunal. And I think that also the issue of the book is very interesting, that the losing side in the legal battle, or at least in the international tribunal, is lodging a real battle within the epistemic community by books, article, EGEL talk, that we see something in parallel. Okay, we opened the floor to your questions or any comment, and please raise your hand and present yourself. Yes. Sergei, can you present yourself, please?
Is it working? Yeah. So I'm Sergei Vasily from Leiden University, and I would like to thank all panelists for their very interesting presentations and for very rich attempts to define debacle or failure in international adjudication. I would actually like to request all panelists to refocus on this conceptual issue, what a debacle is. And before you give the answer to this question, perhaps might be useful to bring forward a few considerations. So most of you have tried to define debacle negatively. So a failure of international adjudication is a failure to achieve something. But can there be a positive definition to this notion? So a set of objective criteria. For example, there is a big danger of in trying to define the debacle to attribute to a court someone else's failure or success. So my point would be, should not we define debacle or failure by the functions of the court or tribunal, as opposed to, for example, the parameters of context or behavior of states? For example, non-compliance with the judgment of the court is not a failure of the court, it is the failure of that respective state. The same when we talk about the survival of courts, which are basically dependent on the context. So sometimes the ability of the court to survive and to adjust to the changing circumstances can be actually a failure, especially if the court is driven into submission to great powers. This might be perceived as a failure as well. So in this, from this perspective, the Darwinist concept would not fully work. Similarly, when it comes to the cross-fertilization between international courts, if a specific judgment of a court is cited by other courts and its judicial rationales are well received by other international courts, there is a temptation to define this as a success as opposed to failure. But again, it is not something that the donor court can fully control. It depends on the behavior of other actors. So that would be my cross-cutting challenge. Aren't we defining the notion of debacle and failure too broadly so that this concept basically loses its explanatory power?
Okay, thank you. Let's take another several questions and then we would let them to respond. Yeah, any other question? Yes. Could you present
Thank
yourself?
Thank you, yes. I am Andrea Gattini, I'm guest at the Institute. So my question is partly linked to the question of Vasily, but is more focusedly directed to Professor Forlati. You said that the Southwest African case was so much criticized, the decision by the International Court of Justice, also because it didn't really contribute in no way to the settlement of a dispute. And so my question is, if a court has no jurisdiction, which would be its role for settlement of a case for which it has no jurisdiction? So it's this way my question is linked to that of Vasily, because it seems that the failures is somewhere else. The inability to settle the dispute is political, because the parties are not really moving towards a solution, but it cannot be the responsibility of a court to find a solution where from the beginning it has no jurisdiction. So I think this question is also, I think about, because about this subject, because there is a huge debate, well, huge, big debate about the role of International Court of Justice for provisional measures in a case of an armed conflict. So there is this trend in saying that in any way the International Court of Justice has to do something at the provisional measure stage in order to at least help a little bit towards so they termination of a conflict or the suspension of hostilities or whatever. But I think it's also a little bit, well, it's debatable which role could the court play at the provisional measure stage where it is not even sure it has or no jurisdiction to solve a case which is, of course, much, let's say, the focus is somewhere else. It's not so much in a technical judicial decision or some legal aspects. So thank you.
Thank you. Another one there?
Thank you very much to all speakers. I also have a question.
Could you present yourself,
Sorry.
Please?
My name is Ingo Fenske from the University of Amsterdam. I also have a question for Professors Wojciechowicz Almeida and Forlati. It seems to me that the answer to your research question as you presented it, whether whether compliance can be a sole indicator for success or failure, seems to be somewhat straightforward in the sense, no. I mean, it depends on the contents of the judgment and what the court asks the parties to do, and you account for that, so you do continue and say what we need to look at is then also at how compliance with the judgment contributes to the court's fulfillment of its functions. But I was wondering if you could continue to expand on that and elaborate on how compliance can contribute to that, how more specifically you do take into consideration the demands that the judgment raises, the contents of the judgment in your analysis. You might be familiar with a prominent article of George Downs and others, 1996 already, I think, titled, Is Good News About Compliance Good News About International Cooperation? The main argument being, no, If you don't ask the parties to do anything seriously, if you cater and anticipate their resistance, you might have perfect compliance scores, but you don't gain anything. And you have that on the radar, don't get me wrong, but I would like to invite you to expand a bit on how you can account for that argument. Thank you.
Okay, let's take the last question, and then we would let the speakers to respond. Yes.
Thank you. Marco Beneta, Max Planck Institute. I work on the third floor. I have a question for the presenters of the second paper and for Wim. So for the second paper, first question, in your study of compliance, do you also look at compliance with provisional measures? Because it seems relevant to me to the extent that most international courts consider their own provisional measures to be binding. My second question, how do you know when, or how do you select decisions where you can test compliance? Because in some cases, you'll just have a declaratory judgment where the ICJ will decide that, you know, a state's rights have been violated and that the mere determination constitutes satisfaction. So you can't really test compliance there. And then my question for Wim, it's maybe an observation. I'd like to hear your remarks. So if I understand your conclusion, it's that small states should watch it if they want to institute proceedings against big states for the fear of reputational and other costs. You could say that they do achieve compliance in some cases, it's just not compliance in a formal sense. So let's take the case of Nicaragua. You put a question mark compliance. Formally, maybe not, but look what happened. The Americans stopped financing the Contras after a while. You could say that the judgment had an influence on attitudes within Congress. The president stops the funding. Okay, did they pay compensation? Formally, no. But what happened in the 1990s? They gave a large amount of money in the form of development aid. So, and in the case of the Arctic Sunrise, like you said yourself, they returned the ship. Maybe they didn't say they did it formally to comply with, you know, the provisional measures of the ITLOS, but they did do it on their own terms. And, you know, everyone was released, the ship was returned. As for the South China Sea, well, we'll see what happens. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, I'm sorry, but we have to finish by 11. So I know that it's just next to impossible, but if you could, in 1 minute, give a brief response, or otherwise, I mean, the next panel would be delayed. So please, Dr. Pasquier.
Okay, I start by, I will respond to Sergei Vasily. So if I have understood correctly your question, you're saying, okay, why don't we measure the notion of success or failure, or more specifically failure, on how the courts has done its job and not so much on how the environment reacted to that job. Okay, we could do that, but I still think that, you know, the idea of failure is somehow defined negatively, starting from an expectation. So you have to start from what do you think a good job is in the field of international adjudication. And in the moment you see that a court disappoints that expectation, frustrates that expectation, then you can say, this is a failure, right? You don't agree. I think this is the point. I think this is the point, and otherwise you cannot affirm that this is a failure, because you can only fail to do something you're supposed to do. So you have to start from a social expectations about what the court should do or not do, from my point of view. And also, well, I think that in the end you cannot exclude the environment element, because, for instance, well, criminal courts are supposed to fight impunity. Can we say that they do? Well, the rhetoric is this one. But they cannot if they do not have social support. No court can do what it's supposed to do if it doesn't have social support. So, well, this is my answer to your question. I've disappointed you, so it was a failure. Or maybe from your point of view, it is a success. I don't know. But who decides whether they are reasonable or not? This is why I'm saying we need shared premises. Once you have a shared premise, you can say, according to this shared premise, in this epistemic community, what you're saying doesn't seem really reasonable. Otherwise, what doesn't seem reasonable to you makes some seem reasonable to someone else. And
the common ground should be the job profile of the court, so it's direct mandate. That's what we can agree
so
on.
So, okay, so your point would be to refer back to the statute of the court. Okay.
To the powerful state. Okay, yes, Dr. Almeida.
Well, I'll try to group the questions as there are many questions for us. And thank you very much for your interest in our presentation. So we're going to organize as well. I'll try to answer and then I'll pass the floor to Serena and then I think we'll get the whole picture. And well, for I think your first question is on debacles, no? That we maybe most of us we try to define debacles as in a negative way. And well, as for our paper, we try to define the debacles and also we try to assess the success of international courts on the basis of several factors, which are the functions. So I can say that it's more positive in this way because success for us is linked to the accomplishment of all the functions of the of a given international court and tribunal. So so it's not necessarily linked to the impact to one party or a specific party to this judgment. So non-compliance for us is not a failure because it may even compromise one of the functions of international courts and tribunals, which is dispute settlement. But in any case, it's not determinant because as I mentioned, disputes. Some disputes may be solved by other means other than compliance. So for us, it's mostly on the positive aspect. What else? And if we take into consideration the content of the judgment, yes, we mentioned this when we were evaluating compliance and the factors that affect compliance. I think this was asked by Ingo, right? And then we evaluate the intrusive and the onerous character of the judgment. Of course, that if the judgments they go far, they try to impose some restrictions on the state. For example, structural changes or legal modifications or something that goes further than just reparations. Of course, this would be more difficult to be complied with. And we mentioned this. As well, and we developed this in our paper, but I don't think we will have time here to to touch on every single aspect developed there. But I'll be happy to discuss it with you because we used a lot some of your thoughts with Bogdanzi in our introduction on the multifunctional character of the court. And what else? If we also look at compliance on provisional measures. No, we only use compliance. We only use the reference to provisional measures when we were mentioning the ways in which the court could control implementation, could control the execution of judgments, and so we only mentioned this for this purpose. But we know that after Lagrand, the provisional measures they are binding, but we just decided to look on final judgments. And how do we test compliance? We know that this, we even try to explain or to define it in our introduction. We know that there are several ways to define compliance. In some ways, there are more quantitative ways, and they also pose a lot of problems because if you define compliance of a judgment, for example, because a state, non-compliance because a state did not comply after 1 year after the judgment was rendered, then it's very difficult because you just have a time lapse, a specific time lapse. So we try to avoid this and we define compliance as accepting the judgment as final and reasonable in good faith. And we try to find the common, let's say, the more cases where it's obvious that there was non-compliance, and I think Serena will be able to give more details on this, on the second part. Thank you.
Yes, I will not go through what Paola has already said. I would just refer as regards success or failure to the fact that we also think that there is a lot in between complete success and complete failure. So it is not possible to, you know, have a clear-cut opposition between the two. As to the question of Andrea Gattini, what about the role of a court in settling a dispute over which it has no jurisdiction? I think in Southwest Africa, the problem was precisely that the court, it was not a matter of jurisdiction, actually, of admissibility. But let's take a general stance on the issue. I think the failure in Southwest Africa was linked to the fact that the court, on one hand, did not appropriately assess the law as regards to Ustandi, and at the same time, it did not meaningfully provide for contribution to the settlement of the dispute. So I think the two aspects were somehow failed in that case. If you think of Barcelona Traction, which came a few years later, there the court reversed the finding on the law. It still failed to provide a meaningful contribution to the settlement of the dispute. In this respect, in the second respect, the case may be considered to be a failure, but then the law, the impact of the law was so important that it somehow counterbalanced the fact, even there, there was no problem of implementation, of course, but the fact that there was no meaningful contribution to the dispute settlement aspect. As regards declaratory judgments and provisional measures. Well, first of all, maybe it's good to stress that the problems of compliance relate to different aspects depending on each court and tribunal. And it's true that provisional measures do have a strong relevance in that context as well, although we didn't take it, analyze it specifically. But one should also mention the fact that, for instance, in international as regards international criminal courts, there is really no big problem of compliance with judgments. The problems of compliance are much at a much more preliminary stage of being able to apprehend suspects who cannot be tried in absentia as a general rule. So the problems of compliance can relate to many different phases of a court's judicial task. And as regards declaratory judgments, I think this is precisely one of the areas where there may be no issue of case-specific compliance, but where the impact in the assessment of the law is more prominent. And you can assess the success of a court in terms of its ability to, for instance, shape national legal systems, or to, in any case, change the overall attitude of the state. If you take Nicaragua once again, there was a finding by the court that the USA had violated a number of legal obligations, and there was a finding that it should refrain from further breaches of the same kind. Well, these two aspects are linked, of course, but even if you have a simply declaratory judgment, one would expect that the losing party takes into account the finding of the court and changes its attitude. So there is a way to test compliance, even as regards declaratory judgments.
Yes. And it applies also to advisory opinions,
yes,
I think, which are quite similar.
Yes, I agree. I hope I haven't forgotten anybody.
Dr. Muller.
Well, I can be relatively brief because thank you, Marco, for your observations. I fully agree with you. I think what you can see is that in the short term, small states will pay a price for taking up a great power, but that in the long term, it actually is a bit of a tool for a small state to stand up to a big state to engage in litigation, as you see in your examples, but also in its public diplomacy. The Philippines also played off this tiny little Philippines taking on a big China in the South China Sea arbitration case. And I think it will also, I still think that in the long term, that arbitration will contribute to China's taking international litigation more seriously, because you already see that there are many capacity building efforts going on inside China, and that obviously the Chinese government has been kind of shocked by the way that this happened, and it means that China has been quite effective in WTO litigation and also in international commercial arbitration. So there's not really a reason why it shouldn't start departing maybe eventually from its policy of not participating in any other international litigation mechanisms. But yeah, so I do agree that for small states, taking on a big state might actually be a good way to safeguard their own interests, and maybe also a better way than any other ones. But they need to have a long, they have to be a bit patient and be willing to play the long game.
Okay. I think that we've heard many interesting questions, and the speakers, of course, couldn't answer all of them, but we can continue this discussion during the break. I'm very grateful to four excellent speakers for very good presentations, and thank you very much.